we are able to receive a lot of ideas that homeopathy in our country is in danger. And the alarm is raised that the type of homeopathy that has been taught by Hahnemann is not currently viable. Now we must understand that this alarm is raised in different quarters. When Hahnemann mentioned in his first aphorism that the only mission of a homeopathic physician is to cure, I think he was laying great emphasis on the attitude with which a physician encounters his work as well as the patients for whom he cares. And all subsequent aphorisms have tried to emphasize on the methods that need to be employed. Many years later, H.A. Roberts, in his Principles of Cure in Homeopathy, in his chapter 1, makes a very interesting point. He says that what has homeopathy to offer a homeopath is not a question. In fact, we have to ask the reverse question. What has homeopath to offer to homeopathy? And in that he has mentioned very, very clearly that certain qualities of a homeopath are important. The first quality is stability. In the face of adverse circumstances, the homeopath and his mind has to be extremely balanced, because only when he is in balance that he is able to observe. And Hahnemann has mentioned the qualities of an unprejudiced observer. The second quality that Roberts emphasizes is the quality of patience. That a homeopath has to wait, and several times, several classical homeopaths have mentioned or have enjoined upon us that when in doubt, wait. Do not jump from one prescription to another, because that is likely to spoil the case. The third aspect of a homeopath's attitude, which Roberts emphasizes, is that a homeopath must have a genuine desire to help the afflicted. And this is important because in our day and time, when we are pressed with so many conflicting desires, conflicting pulls and pressures, the need to focus on help and delivering help without expectations of any material return, I think that is extremely important for a homeopath. And it is here that a homeopathy runs very close to a spiritual discipline. We all know that Gita has been telling us that to work without expectation of a reward. It is not that the Gita tells us that there will be no reward. The Bhagavad Gita is emphasizing that we as individuals, as professionals, must take care to see that our focus is not on what we will get, any selfish desire, but on the need to do good to the best of our ability. Now, if we look at what Hahnemann has mentioned, what Roberts has mentioned, a lot of times we find that the current world that we are moving in is moving at a pace and in a manner that threatens homeopathy. But you will be surprised that Hahnemann was such a sage that he had a prescient notion of what is to come. In his memorable letter to the Duke, who asked him for advice on how to choose a homeopath, he has described a number of caricatures of homeopaths. And I think we can see these caricatures today. People who strut about, people who are, you know, giving them a lot of image, people who rush to the media with any small success that they have. And Hahnemann says, please shun them. Please avoid them because they are not the true homeopaths for you. Try to search a homeopath who is diligent, who records all that you are saying, who takes time to consider what action he should take. And finally, in the postscript, a very interesting observation that Hahnemann gives is that observe what the homeopath does when he is not observed. And I think that gives the true value which a homeopath carries in our society today. It is not the media. It is not the Facebook. It is not anything else but what integrity means to a homeopath. How he answers himself when he is faced with a question of helping a patient, how to help a patient, and how he finds these answers which are true to his conscience. And Dr. M.L. Dhawale, when he established the ICR, and when we are trying to bring about education according to the philosophy and values that he put down, we have been trying to concentrate on firstly developing the attitude with which a homeopath encounters his world. And in that, we are exposing our students to varied circumstances. They go to the villages, they go to the rural areas, they go to the tribal areas. They are able to see suffering at close quarters. And that is what imbibes in them the value of what they have received from society and how it is important that they give back to society a small part of what they have received. And following the methods that Sir has laid down, we are able to instill in the student the discipline of observation, discipline of recording, discipline of analysis, discipline of consulting the library, consulting the various source books, and then conferring in a team. Because group learning is what the world is today about. Individualized solo learning is now over. We have to build a team effort in order to try to further the reach of homeopathy in areas which it has not reached. And we are glad to say that we are having several projects in which we are trying to test the practice of scientific homeopathy in areas like learning disorders, in areas like end stage kidney disease, in areas like autism. So we are able to produce documented evidence because our students have been trained to do this work. And over a period of time, when we are able to publish this, we will be able to demonstrate objectively to a world which is willing to listen that homeopathy has a role to play in the modern world in spite of all the pressures that we are living. Homeopathy can bring a balance in our lives and fulfill our lives, enhance the quality of life that we are living. And I think that would be the best advantage, the best value addition in a homeopath's life.